Hello out there and welcome to this video about my little experimental electric motor. You see here a stepper motor with a stator consisting of 12 electromagnets. Each of the rotor discs features 4 permanent magnets. Every single electromagnet can be enabled by a transistor. Those transistors are activated by a microprocessor of the Atmel company. It is an Atmega 8A and you can see it at the bottom left of the board. I'll turn the motor around to show you the rotor disc. The red marked north poles of the magnets are pointing to the camera, the south poles to the background. You can find a detailed construction guidance including the used software at the homepage of the project. I will attach the control electronics to the voltage source now, which is a power supply of an old personal computer. As you can see, the electromagnets are enabled one after the other, by what the nearest of the 4 permanent magnets is attracted by the enabled inductor. The rotor disc is following the spinning magnetic field. The turn-on time of the electromagnets can be shortened with the help of a potentiometer, by what the disc is rotating faster. As you can see, the rotor disc is always oscillating around its relative position. As a consequence of these oscillations, the rotor can't follow the rotating magnetic field as soon as the turn-on times of the inductors become too short. The rotor is shaking around. By extending the turn-on time, the disc is following the magnetic field again. There are 4 permanent magnets at each rotor disc, so 4 electromagnets can be enabled simultaneously, by what the torque is increasing. The rotor is oscillating stronger around its position, hence the rotor disc stops rotating more early as soon as the turn-on time is shortened. With a special hand grip, the oscillation of the rotor disc can be damped. By touching the rotor spindle, the motor is rotating clockwise, even if the turn-on time is very short. With the help of a push button, the direction of rotation can be altered. A short push is not enough to trigger the change of direction. The button has to be pressed for more than 1 second. The magnetic field caused by the inductors is rotating in the opposite direction by now. The light of the LEDs is running from the top to the bottom. The turn-on time and the number of simultaneously enabled electromagnets can be varied for this rotation direction too. By using a jumper, the software of the microcontroller is instructed to alter the mode. As you can see, only 3 of the inductors are enabled from now on. Nevertheless, the rotor is still rotating clockwise. With the help of the potentiometer, further triplets can be activated to increase the torque. Arranging the electromagnets in triplets allows the usage of inductors having different properties. According to the operation conditions, the appropriate inductors can be enabled by the software. That's working forward as well as in reverse direction. If the jumper is inserted in another position, six inductors, strictly spoken two triplets, are used to control the motor by now. As you can see, I reconverted the electric motor. There are 8 permanent magnets at each rotor disc by now, and the south poles are pointing to the camera. Using this construction, the electromagnets of the stator are repelling the permanent magnets of the rotor disc. If you look at the red marks of the microcontroller, you can see that this device has been replaced. The control software has been customized for this kind of rotor disc. I'm now attaching the board to the voltage source. While looking at the LEDs, you will notice that the transistors aren't enabled in series any longer. On its way to the top, the running light jumps back from time to time. At the counterclockwise rotation, the light jumps up on its way down. You can read more about this control principle at the project page. By using this software, 6 respectively 3 inductors are sufficient to control the rotor too. Torque and switch time can be varied as usual. This stepper motor will be turned into a normally operating electric motor with the next stage of reconstruction. What for, the control software has to be replaced again. I'm sure you've already noticed the metal disc at the rotor. The rotation of this disc is indicated by 2 photosensors whose switching status can be observed by looking at the 2 red LEDs at the top of the board. While spinning the disc slowly, you can see those LEDs blinking. With the help of this sensor disc, the control software can detect the position of the rotor and switch the inductors in an adequate way. Like before, the electromagnets are grouped in triplets, and by using the potentiometer, more or less of those triplets can be activated, so that the torque, respectively the revolution speed, is altered. This control principle is working in forward as well as in reverse direction. Another safety feature is the fact that the direction of rotation can't be altered while the motor is running. As soon as the motor stops rotating and the push button is pressed for more than 1 second, the software alters the direction of rotation. The turn-on time is controlled by the sensor disk from now on, so the second pulley operates as the brake pedal. By activating a jumper, the automatic speed control can be turned on. If throttle is reduced to zero, the motor continues to rotate with constant speed. You can see that the control software activates another triplet from time to time. If I slow down the motor, it is better to do this from the other side, the microcontroller increases the torque automatically to keep the constant rotation speed. While using the brake pedal, the speed control is skipped and the motor stops. The sensor disk can be used to implement a revolution counter. It is made of another microcontroller and 12 LEDs. One of the photo sensors operates as a signaler. The pulses of the sensor are counted to calculate the accordant number of revolutions. The result is displayed as LED bar, at which one LED equals 50 rounds per minute. The two red LEDs operate as overflow counter. If a motor speed of 500 rounds per minute is reached, those two LEDs count up in binary system and the LED bar starts on the left side again. Thus, revolution speeds up to 2000 rounds per minute can be displayed. Here you can see the revolution counter in full view. With the help of the jumper, the display mode can be switched. Now the number of revolutions is given as a 12-bit binary value. The left LED represents the lowest bit. In doing so, revolution speeds up to 4095 rounds per minute can be displayed. Now it is time to measure the electric input power. The right multimeter displays the input voltage and the left one the current running through the stator. As soon as I'm opening the throttle, A current is running through the inductors, which decreases slightly at increasing revolution speeds. At the minus sign, you can see that the polarity of the left multimeter is wrong, but that should not matter here. Whenever I'm boosting the throttle, the current increases immediately, but decreases slightly in the following. While slowing down the motor with my thumb, the current running through the stator is increasing significantly. While slowing down with the help of the brake pedal, the current increases too. The sign of the current value is not altering. The braking operation is not recuperative, so there is no gain of electric energy from the kinetic energy of the motor. Let's switch the direction of rotation and accelerate again. The direction of the current is still the same. The change of rotation direction is not done by switching the polarity of the inductors, but by altering the activation sequence. Let's do a little temperature measurement at one of the power transistors. As soon as the motor starts running, the temperature is increasing slightly. That indicates losses, which are increasing in conjunction with the current running through the transistor. Those losses should be eliminated as far as possible. I will stop the rotation of the motor to increase the current up to its maximum value. As a consequence, the temperature is increasing faster. This test arrangement is used to measure the torque of the motor. A cord is wrapped around the rotor axis and one end is attached to a hairy white. This white is arranged on a kitchen scale, with what the acting force can be detected. As soon as the motor starts turning, the white is lifted and the cordon value can be read. If revolution speed, diameter of the rotor axis and the electric input power are known, you can calculate the efficiency of the motor. An analysis of the indicated values is given at the homepage of the project. You'll have already noticed that this motor can be controlled in a very flexible way. By now, I would like to demonstrate further possibilities to alter the parameters of the motor by software. To do so, the jumpers are used once again. Jumper number 1 instructs the software to shift the switching point of the inductors. As you can see, the revolution speed increases, even though there are still just 3 of the electromagnets active. While deactivating this functionality, the revolution speed decreases. jumper number 2 leads to an even higher increase of the revolution speed. Now the turn on time is brought forward in time, while the turn off time is kept. Thus, the turn on times of neighbored inductors overlap. With the help of altering switch times, the torque can be adjusted according to different operation conditions. Shifting both points of switching by using jumper number 1 leads to an unwanted effect. The motor doesn't start turning if the jumper is set. The jumper has to be removed to start the motor. If the jumper is activated while the motor is running, the wanted effect of increasing torque appears. Using the variation of overlapping switch times doesn't inhibit the motor from starting. The overlapping of switch times can be demonstrated by using an oscilloscope. The switch times of two inductors are displayed. As you can see, the edges of both graphs are below each other, while the jumper is deactivated. By attaching the jumper, the revolution speed is increasing and the width of the pulses is reduced. Besides this, you can see that the edges of the blocks are no longer below each other. While removing the jumper, those edges are exactly below each other once again. Well, that's all for today, folks. Thanks for watching.